The name of this video is Auxiliary Free Magnetic Field H vector. Clearly, vector H has a similar role as vector D, the auxiliary free electric field, has for dielectric materials. H has the same role for magnetic materials. Since there is a strict analogy between these two concepts, let us remember what happens when we have conductors and dielectric materials. In this case, we can write the total charge density in a volume rho is given by the rho C associated with the charge-free carrier, so it's the conduction rho. We can also call it the rho F for free, same concept, plus rho P, which is the polarization charge. This is true in a volume. Similarly, on a surface, small sigma will be given by sigma C or sigma F plus sigma P. In analogy, in presence of both conductors and magnetic materials, in presence of both, rho is substituted by J vector, the current density. The total current density is given by the conduction currents present in conductors plus the magnetization currents Jm present in the magnetic materials, which we already encountered previously in this course. Similarly, if I consider a surface, for example, the interface between two different magnetic materials, and there could be some conducting materials as well, sandwiched in between, J on the surface, S subscript for surface, is given by J on the surface conductor plus J on the surface magnetic. Now remind you again that JC is the conduction current, density vector, whereas Jm is the magnetization current. Thus, the question we ask, can we write something like Ampere's law in the case of in presence of magnetic materials? Well, before doing so, let us remind ourselves that in presence of magnetic materials, of course, this magnetic materials is an Avogadro number, a large ensemble of little loops of currents. And as we've seen in the previous videos, we can approximate all the currents in these loops to be steady currents. So assuming steady currents, which is a good assumption for Jm, and let's assume that also Jc are all steady currents for simplicity. So assuming steady currents, then it so happens that the total current intensity, these are densities, vectors, the intensity is a scalar, I, is given by IC, the conduction current intensity, plus the magnetization current intensity, IM. And this, as always, under steady conditions, can be written as the flux through a surface, which we call capital sigma gamma, which is a border gamma, it's an open surface, with border gamma of J total dot NDA, which again is only true because we're considering, we're assuming steady currents as we've done in FIS242. So the next question is, can we write down Ampere's law? So Ampere's law actually the accent is on the other side, to be precise. Ampere's law in presence of magnetic materials. So how can we write it down? Well, clearly Ampere's law is still valid, and it's valid for, let's say, B. And now the aim is to go from B vector to H vector. So let's write Ampere's law as we know it from FIS242. So we know that the curl of B is given by, in general, mu naught times the total current intensity J in local form, case one, differential form. We know that J is given by the linear superposition of JC plus JM. And from previous videos, we have demonstrated using a simple model that JM is equal to the curl of M, M being the magnetization vector. Therefore, we can rewrite this expression by dividing everything by mu naught and replacing JM with the curl of M. So let's do exactly that. So we obtain the curl, clearly we have two curls, the curl of B and the curl of M. So we can take the curl of M divided by mu naught, of course. So let's remember that. The curl of M, we can take it to the left-hand side and we can factor out the operation of curl. So we obtain the curl of two quantities. B, of course, remains as such, but we divide it by mu naught. So it's B divided by mu naught minus, because we take the curl of M on the left-hand side, M, if we divide by mu naught goes away. So it's simply M minus M. Only B gets divided by mu naught, obviously. So now we have the curl of B divided by mu naught, the curl of M with a minus sign, this we divide by mu naught, so this has to be equal to just JC. Here we can define a new quantity, which we call H, and this new quantity is defined as B divided by mu naught, as prescribed by this equation, minus capital M vector. This new vector H is what we call the auxiliary free magnetic field H. Why do we call this quantity free? In analogy to capital D, which we defined in presence of the electric materials, we can simply write that the curl of H is equal to JC. So Ampere's law for H, on the right-hand side, there is no mu naught, which we had here in general for B, and there is only JC. So only the conduction current, which means this field is free from any magnetization current, and that's why it's useful to define it. So it's free from any magnetization current. That's what this means. And this is, in local form case 1, the differential form, that is, of Ampere's law for H. We can readily move by means of Stokes' theorem to the integral form of this equation, so how do we obtain the integral form? So this one is case one, differential form. So how do we obtain the integral form? Again, Stokes' theorem. So any curl becomes a circulation. Along what? The line gamma defined here, which is the border of capital sigma gamma. And so simply we can rewrite in this case, the line integral. It's a circulation over closed line gamma. Gamma is a closed line. Capital sigma gamma is an open surface, which has gamma as a border again, of H dot TDL, circulation of H. But clearly, if you look at the definition of H, you can see that this is nothing but 1 over mu naught, let's use it, circulation of B minus the circulation of M dot TDL, which we encountered previously in another video when we introduced the model for magnetic materials. Well, what is the circulation of B? Well, divided by mu naught, this is nothing but the total current I, which is IC plus IM. Ampere's law for B. Minus the circulation of M, what is that? We have proven in a previous video, that is nothing but minus IM, which as expected results in this equation, which tells us that the circulation of H is equal to IC. And again, also in integral form, the result is free from IM, is only given by the current intensity, conducting current intensity, IC. This integral form is more general than the local form case one, and that is the one eventually need to use if you have a surface of separation between materials, which is case two. We will briefly discuss about this later on. Instead here, the next step, the next point, is to study, instead of Ampere's law for H, something like Gauss's theorem, if you want, for H. So we know that for B, we have the solenoidal property, the divergence of B is equal to zero. For H, we end up having something like Gauss's theorem. And in fact, we shall see many analogies between H and E, the electrostatic field, under certain conditions. We'll discuss this later on in some examples. So in this case, in local form, case one, that is differential form, from the definition, the divergence of H is given by 1 over mu naught, divergence of B, minus divergence of M but we know that B is solenoidal, therefore the divergence of B is equal to zero, which means the divergence of H is equal minus divergence of M in local form. We can give it a name, this is a scalar, and we call it minus rho M. Now, a few caveats here. So the local form case one differential form, that is of Gauss's theorem for H, is the divergence of H is equal minus rho M, which is given by minus the divergence of M, capital M. So this rho m is what we call magnetization charge doesn't mean that there are monopoles. So it seems here that we have some magnetic charge in our hands. Well, if you write down the integral form of this equation, which is what we're about to do here, this is case one. Now let's look at the integral form. For this Gauss, in this case, okay, so the integral form for Gauss from the divergence theorem, every time we have a divergence, we end up having the surface integral over a closed surface, capital sigma, which encloses a region omega of space of h dot nda. So this has to be equal to minus the same integral over capital sigma omega of m dot nda, the flux of m. We have divergences both on the left and gradient side. Well, clearly this one is given by the integral of this quantity, rho m, which we call minus qm. However, if this is all a closed region and is all the material is confined within this region, clearly it has to be that this has to sum up to zero. So if I give you a magnetized sphere, the overall magnetic charge or magnetization charge has to be equal to zero. However, this doesn't mean, and let me give you a quick example here, which we will encounter later on. If I give you a magnet of this shape, which is, let's say, uniformly magnetized with vector m in this direction uniformly, we will study this in a few videos from now. Very important example. Well, in this case, as it turns out, there will be a minus qm localized at this interface and a plus qm localized at this interface. The overall is qm minus qm equals zero. Let's give it some name so that we don't confuse it with this qm. So this we call it south, because it's going to be on the south pole, and this one we call it north, which is going to be on the north pole. We'll come back to this. So north plus south, of course, gives me zero. However, if I use this Gauss's theorem only for one of the two surfaces, let's say this surface here, I use this theorem for this surface, which we shall do soon, well, then you will find a charge which is different than zero. So you need to be careful when you use this theorem, because magnetic monopoles still were not found. However, if you use it in certain locations locally, as we shall do, you may end up finding a charge which seems different than zero, but you need to remember that the whole material has an overall magnetic charge or magnetization charge which remains zero. So this is quite a critical point to remember for later on. So it is also worth pointing out a few analogies between H and D. Between H and D. The first one is that, by definition, D has a similar definition, is epsilon not E. Note that here we have B over mu naught. Typically, epsilon and mu are inverted between the two fields. And here we have plus P instead of minus M polarization vector. In addition, we should remember that in local form, let's only focus at the on the local form here. What is the gradient, sorry, what is the curl of D? Well, in static conditions, the curl of D is zero, so it's equal to the curl of P. So this has a similar concept as this one for the divergences. Curl and divergences are always inverted between the two fields, E and B, and D and H, respectively. Whereas the divergence of D is equal to epsilon naught E, divergence of E, plus divergence of P. So this one, it's clearly Gauss's theorem for D is nothing but rho C. It's a free field, it only depends on the conduction currents. So again, which is a similar analogy as the curl of H is equal to JC, here is divergence of D, which is equal to rho C. Here we have that the divergence of H is equal minus divergence of M. Here we have the curl of D, which is equal to the curl of P. So there is an analogy always swapping curl and dot product and divergences and inverting epsilons and mu's. In addition, the other interesting feature is that, as we have seen for the electric materials, the uniformity or not of the fields, as well as the geometries, make a difference whether D, for example, is conservative or not. Similar arguments apply for H. However, there is something which is very important to point out immediately, and is that the curl of H is equal to JC. So what happens when JC is equal to zero? Well, the curl of H is equal to zero. And if we're considering a simply connected domain that is a star domain, a compact domain, well then, because of Poincaré's lemma, this means that H is irrotational but also conservative, which means we can represent it as a scalar potential, with a scalar potential. This is quite interesting, and we shall use it extensively soon. So to summarize this video, auxiliary free magnetic field H, we made a comparison between conductors and dielectric materials and conductors and magnetic materials. In the latter case, J vector is given by the conduction currents JC plus JM, the magnetization current, similarly on the surfaces. Ampere's law, case one, in local form, differential form, very simply tells us that the curl of B is equal to mu naught the total J. By regrouping things, we can define a new field, which is called H, the auxiliary free magnetic field H, which is B over mu naught minus M. Is free because the curl of H is equal to JC. In integral form, of course, we just do the circulation of H, which is going to be nothing but IC, the intensity of the conduction current. What about Gauss's theorem for H? Well, the divergence of H is minus divergence of M, which behaves as a sort of a source, minus REM, we call it, magnetization charge, with the caveat that if I integrate over an entire region, I need to get zero, but locally I can get non-zeros, and we will use this concept to understand the north and south poles of a magnet. But again, since we didn't find monopoles, the overall sum has to be overall zero. And in fact, even if you slice this magnet at each phase, you will have plus and minus Q. So of course, the final result is still zero. We'll come back to that in a few videos. The analogy between H and D is that this defined similarly as epsilon naught E plus P. But instead of the curl of H equal JC, now the curl of D is the curl of P, which is the same as these divergence relations here. And the divergence of D is rho C, which is similar to this equation up here. That's it.